Hey guys, how's it going? Let me get y'all up here in the crane. Here we go. How's it going? Good to see y'all. We're working on medical coding. Where am I at? Oh, I'm on the E&M section. Let's see. How's it going? Let's see. Let me get my other book over here to this page. I have a lot of anatomy to go over tonight. So that's going to be cool. This is critical care, right before critical care. 291. Hey guys. Hey go-kart. Good to see you. Hey Lash. You're watching from the Bahamas. Yay. That's awesome. Hey PJ. Hope I can help y'all. Four, six, six. Hey, Sunshine, good to see you. I was throwing your name into the cookie jar a couple of times today for being a subscriber. We're going to do some drawings on Friday. Also, the YouTube subscribers, too, are getting some their names put in the cookie jar, too. Inpatient. Neonate. And I'm on physician directing transport. That's awesome, Marie Maxwell. That's awesome. I'll have your name in there a bunch of times. That's awesome. I hope you're enjoying looking at the old workshops, especially the E&M ones. That was my very first two that we did. So those are really good workshops. You get 50 E&M questions and get to see me do them. So that's really, really cool. We gotta do not. Good, you've been watching E&M today. Right now I am you're at deer camp. Oh, wow. You're missing everybody. Hey, Red. Good to see you. It's been a while. She's having trouble. E&M. What page, which book are you using? Right now, I'm in the 2023. I'm right before the codes for critical care of 99466. Just looking at the guidelines, seeing if there's anything I need to underline real quick while we got it. We've got some do nots, of course, that I like to underline in red. Do not report services 15 minutes or less. We want to make sure that I do not report that one in conjunction with that too. So what you can do is go to your 99485 and 99486 and verify that the parenthetical is there that says don't use those codes with these two. Sometimes they don't have a parenthetical, and then that's where you would want to go, right? Do not use with those. You don't want to just leave it up here in the middle of a paragraph somewhere away from the code. So, yeah, it's page 42 of the 2023 book, but in the 2022 book, you're around pages 60. Yes, no? 58. Somewhere around 58. And 59. Somewhere around in there. I do the one-on-ones on Zoom. Unless we're having technical difficulties, a few people, I don't know what happens, but if they're following me on Facebook, then I can do it on Messenger too, because it has a video thingy too. Emergency room department. Yeah, sorry, 57. Yeah, some of these got all moved around, and so they're not in the same spots for last year's book compared to this year's book. They did rearrange a lot of them. Face to face. There it is. Okay. So that non-face-to-face one is important. We want to underline the two-way communication is not considered to be face-to-face. And should not be reported as that and that. Howdy, howdy, baking. Good to see you. Awesome. Well, we can for sure do any of those PEDS questions you've got or I've got that I bought. Yes, absolutely. Sure can during tutoring. Right now, I don't have any tutoring sessions available. They're all booked up for right now. As soon as I can, I will open it up. Hoping to be able to open it up in the next 4 or 5 more days, but right now, I'm just totally booked. That's why joining in on these lives is almost like a one-on-one, but you just have to get my attention in chat. But you do have other people here to help. Twinkle and MK and PJ and Red, they've all been here for a long time, seeing a lot of my lives, so they can all help to answer questions for sure. And I did post Monday night's live. It is up on YouTube. I think I did that yesterday. I'm looking. Where am I at? Where's my videos? And I posted a new video up on YouTube today and TikTok. Repeat live from the 14th. Wasn't that Monday? Was that Monday? Yeah, that was Monday. It is up. I posted it up yesterday. So it is good. Good to go. 2 hours and 9 minutes. That one. The name is called Repeat Live 1114. And then I did another video today. Awesome. You're sitting, Maxwell, you're sitting December 10th. And love joining on these. Awesome. Yep. I think I got to everything. Twinkle and go-kart. Y'all are so cute. My team is struggling with critical care coding. They just don't seem to agree. Well, I wonder what in the world. Critical care. I love critical care because, especially the 291, because then you just gotta pick a time. For sure. They do have a lot of back and forth in here and repeating themselves sometimes with all these guidelines. Let me see. And where was I at? The physician was here. Voice communication. Yep. Emergency room department. Yep. Critical care can happen anywhere in the hospital, too. So they could already be admitted in the hospital and be in, I don't know, the cardiac wing of the hospital, and it'd be a subsequent visit. But in the middle of that subsequent day visit, we end up having a critical care situation that happens where we have to go intubate or work on an ECMO or something happens. And we rush in and we devote 100% of our time to that patient, stabilizing them. We can bill a critical care in the middle of a subsequent hospital visit. So it does get tricky. It does get tricky for sure. My exam is on the 17th of December. I'm having a hard time processing of elimination. It is something that you need to learn, the process of elimination. Sometimes it's easier if you just look at two codes that are close together, see if they're in the same header before you look at CPT code descriptors. Headers before descriptors, and that can help you eliminate things easier too. Oh, Red, I've already got it in my head that you passed like 8 weeks ago or something. So I feel like you should be ready because I know you're going to pass. I've already seen it. I swear I thought you already did. Where am I at? Non-face-to-face. Over here. Okay. And then the next one is communication transportation. Yeah. We'll underline that one. We know that. And it's based on age. And then down here, we've got another red one where something down here may not be reported separately. So we've got pediatric patients transported by a physician providing critical care. You may not report these things separately for your pediatric patients. And it goes all the way here to all the way here. So I just kind of mark it that it goes from there, goes to there. It's all these things. Same thing as your adults mostly. It's the EKGs, the blood gases, those kinds of things. Don't get billed with those. Pulse ox, heart rate, respiratory, blood pressure. Pulse ox, we're not going to bill any of that. Pacing, gastric intubation. Now, intubation for breathing is a different thing. Vascular access. Yeah. Any of them that is not listed above should be reported separately. So, any other items that are not listed here can be billed separately. So that's a green for go. We can bill things separately, but they have to be ones that are not listed in that paragraph right there. Yeah, I'm prepping the 2023 book, but just in case you don't have the notes in your 2022 books or which sentences are important for you to know for the exam, which one of these sentences have been prior exam questions, that's what I'm trying to look at and show you right now, which ones are important for you to know that so is a exam question. To know that this has been a prior exam question. Yep, that paragraph is always on the exam. Make sure you understand the ins and outs of that sucker. All right, and then Services. This sentence is important. Services provided by a specialized transport team during a non-face-to-face are not reported by the control physician. We're going to do an extra line for the not. So that we know that one. What else? I have another one right here that says face-to-face services right here. Usually it's always the last sentence in any paragraph is something that's important for the CPC exam. Should not be reported. So face-to-face services of less than 30 minutes should not be reported. Yep, yep, yep. We know only once per day to service is important. And then we've got that non-face-to-face. So I have some anatomy questions, and then we can do a poll real quick or something, and I can and y'all can ask me which sections y'all want to do questions on after we get through with the anatomy questions that I've got prepped for tonight. I didn't prep any CPT ones, but I've got tons of them, so y'all can just tell me what you want to go over, and I'll pull up a bunch and we'll go do them. Anything that has a notice like this underneath the code that says use this code with that code, that's important to know. I like to underline them. And this is an each, so we know we get to times that one. And that one's pretty important, that parenthetical right here, critical care, that is less than 30 minutes. That's a prior question on the exam. We're going to use an appropriate E&M visit. So if they're in the hospital and they're in that situation of getting a subsequent hospital visit by their doctor, and just so happen the code with the doctor there, and we do some critical care for 30 minutes, get their heart beating back again and get them stable. But during that critical care component, during the subsequent hospital visit, if we did intubation on them and we're going to bill for that intubation, we have to take 5 minutes off or whatever the time was it took us to do that procedure off the total time of critical care, because we're going to bill that CPT code for that procedure. We can't bill for that procedure and double our time being paid as critical care on top of it. So if you take 5 minutes away from 30 minutes of critical care, this sentence means that we would just bill our subsequent hospital visit for that day, even though they did have 30 minutes of critical care time. But because we're going to also bill for that intubation, we're not going to be able to bill for the critical care time. So anyway, that sentence is important, and it's usually and has been a prior exam question. And this one, this critical care code means hands-on during transport. And it's going to be for the 24 months of age or younger. Hands-on transport. Doc is in the transporting service, whether it's an airplane, a helicopter, or ambulance. Doc is face to face with the patient, hands on, in that transport vehicle of whatever sort it is. So hands on. And that's just for that minutes. And then we got to add on for additional 30 minutes. And we're going to do that. Our other one is, of course, our favorite one, which is the two-way communication. This is by walkie-talkie, or whatever they use, in depending on the money in the town. But you can, like CB radio, you can envision that. Doc's in the ER talking to the ambulance people and the paramedic, and is communicating orders via that. So that's what that one means. We'll want to do the first 30 minutes, and then the other one will be on the other page. Want to be sure and note the age of the patient too. Is important for that one. Yep. But for now, I'll put away that 2023. As far as pens go, so far, the best without leaking or the ink not drying enough. These are supposed to be quick drying. They say they're quick drying. Two on the pens, quick drying, but they're really not 100% quick enough. Not as much as my Sharpies were quick enough at drying, but this brand is pretty quick at drying so that I don't rub it. And that's the Bic Intensity. And I got this from the Dollar General store. Around the corner from my house. I wasn't even in there looking for that, but saw them and tried them because I was waiting on Walmart to bring me these because they said quick drying, and I just happened to pick up these just because, and they're better than these were. These work just fine. It's just you can get to where you rub across it and it will rub the ink across. It's not as quick as I like it. These are pretty cool. These are good. Be sure and get the fine. It's Bic Intensity Fine. And they're pretty quick at drying. A lot better. Doesn't matter on your highlighters. I just like the push button highlighters because it's a nightmare keeping up with all the caps of everything. So, whatever. Thank you for the... I forgot what little thingy we were looking for today. What TikTok wanted. What did they want? The little paw prints of the kitty cats. That was so cute. Love it. Thank you for making TikTok happy. And... yep, there's the YouTube. We got that going. Let me get up my anatomy going on for tonight. Y'all got to get your thinking caps on. Some of them will be hard. Some of them will be easy. I'm trying to see if my camera's focused. But, oh, thank you for the kitty cat paws. That's so cool. Thank you, guys. That's awesome. Thank you, Sunshine. You're always so helpful. Trying. Let me know if y'all can see. They're always so helpful. Trying. Let me know if y'all can see. They're always so helpful. Trying. Let me know if y'all can see them. The main thing is to make it less stressful too. I know I've seen people just walk out of those exams and just, you know, go sit in their car and cry because they weren't expecting what they saw, and there's no information to tell you exactly what you're going to be facing on that exam day. So I hope to relieve some stress, give you some ideas on where to find answers when, you know, you have no idea where to find an answer. That's always helpful too. But congratulations, Danny. I hope so. I hope that was helpful. The connection is breaking. I'm sorry, guys. It's probably just my brain not connecting. Does she know which exam she got? Exam C is super hard, I think. It's got some harder vocabulary or anatomy in it, too. Ooh, we got tons of little differences. Tons of people saying all kinds of difference. A, B, C, D. So we're looking for surgical connection between two tubular structures. Anybody got any idea on which one is tubular? What was the answer to using the 2022 book on the 2020? I have gone through and was able to turn a 2022 book into a 2023 book, and it's doable. I'm not sure how many notes you have in all the available white space. There's two sections in the book around lab and path and immunizations that you're going to need some extra room on some pages, but luckily it's at the end of each chapter. So we normally write a lot of stuff on the beginning pages of the chapter. So I'm hoping that you still have some of that blank space at the end of one lab, because there's some COVID testing. They added a bunch of new codes for COVID testing. And then the COVID vaccines. There's a bunch of new COVID vaccines. I doubt they'll be on the exam even in 2023, because the codes keep changing and updating so much. So I'm not too worried about those, but all the other sections were easy enough to change. There was no changes to anesthesia. There was only one or two new codes in integumentary, pretty much throughout everything else. E&M, we did delete a bunch of codes, and we combined our inpatient hospital and observation into one code, which is great. So I was able to do it. I posted a document up for like $20-something dollars on Etsy. If you want it, you can download it. It'll show you the picture of the 2022 book of what I changed, but I also attached a picture of what the 2023 code looks like in the 2023 book. So in case you can't read my handwriting, you've at least got it typed out. I think it's a great document. It'll help you save, you know, $160 on a new book and then moving all those notes. So totally up to you. You can do it, though. You're welcome. You're welcome. All right. Answer here. Let's see who is right. Who picked A? Here's the definition for all four. If you don't know, we know that the dysphagia is the difficulty swallowing. A lot of people would know that one. And then the epiglottis has got something to do, I thought, with the tongue, but still, I knew it was throat something or another. So then we've got this one is the adhesions. So, yeah. Be sure and you guessed. Good guessing. Be sure and get those definitions in the book somewhere so that just in case you'll know where to find them. You can also look up these in the ICD-10 book during the exam and figure out which one is the answer by the index. All right. What is nullipara? Don't ask me how to pronounce that. I have no idea. But I hope y'all can see this. I hope the camera is just being so not focus tonight, but it does have something to do with my specialty in OB and delivery. There we go. Maybe it's not as fuzzy there. It's just going to be smaller there. Sorry. So what do you think? I like to just check out never been, never had, pregnant with, never given birth. What is the difference? What's going on here? What's your prefix and what's your suffix? We talked about this on Monday's live where I went over the G and the P, what it means. That may give y'all some hints. Yep. Everybody's got that one. That one's D for never given birth. So this is gravida. How many times have they been pregnant? And then para is how many times have they delivered a healthy baby that lived and survived the birth? So something like that. They might have gravida 2, para 1. Sometimes you might even see them as gravida 2, para 6. What might happen there is they have two sets of triplets. You never know. It's always fun to try to guess how many, or they had one child the first time, and then the second time they had quads, 4, so you never know. It's kind of fun, but the numbers, that's what that means. Here are the answers. Oh, where's the tea? Thank you for sharing the lives. We got 5 shares and 5K hearts. I love having, I was noticing on all the TikToks today that my likes have gone down. I was worried that my videos were, that I post up on TikTok weren't being, I wasn't explaining things well or something because they weren't getting as many likes, like 25% lower. So appreciate the little time to take to tap the heart. Lets me know that the information is helpful. If I'm not explaining it right, though, or in a way that you can understand, let me know and I'll figure out a different way. My middle child had was born with fetal alcohol syndrome, so he learns differently with his continuing issues with that lifelong disability he's going to have. So I did homeschool for him for 8 years, so plus working, sometimes 2 jobs. And so I have learned how to teach him in different ways when he can't understand what it is, whether it's written or math or whatever else. So I'm not offended, y'all. Y'all stop me if you don't understand what in the heck's going on and you need me to explain it in a different way. I can definitely do that. I like puzzles, and that's also one of the things I've always been intrigued or focused as, and so people are like puzzles. So if I explain it one way and it doesn't help you, then I don't have the right puzzle piece for you, so I can find a different puzzle piece. So anyway, do you update your books every year? Yes, I do, for you guys, for sure. Yes, D was the answer. Woman who has never given birth to a child. Yes, D. Yeah, D is the answer. Yep. Very good. Thank you. All right, guys. What about the medical term that means shortening or the act of drawing backwards or the state of being drawn back? Which one of those? Oh, my formatting was just terrible today. I have the worst trouble. You know how Word document, it tries to auto-format things into A, B, C, D, and E, and then sometimes it skips letters. And so sometimes I try not to put in spaces, and sometimes I do, but and then it always moves it and puts it somewhere else. It drives me nuts. I hate the way Word takes these A, B's, and C's and does it all different. Retraction, retroverted, resistance, or refractive. Drawing backwards, being drawn back, or shortening. Shortening is retraction. Yep. Now, traction by itself without the re, we can pull things apart. So there is the definitions for the other ones, just in case you wanted the definitions of the other ones. Because we've got the definition for retraction right there, but there is the definitions for the other words. Or what AAPC would be looking for anyway, just in case. Sorry about the screen being blurry. Does that help? And then that one. There you go. There we go. All right. The following defines a herniation of a bladder into... I don't want TikTok to ban me, so y'all just read the last word. Which one of these... Let me see if I can't get it to focus better. I wish it would focus closer so y'all could see it bigger, but which one is a herniation between those two? Look at your endings. Those would definitely help you. Yep. So we've got probably removals on those. So that could get rid of this. This might be an infection, right? So you just kind of, even if you have no idea, you can figure it out if you know some of your basic prefixes and suffixes. Thank you. Good to see you guys. Answer to that one was B, even though I'm writing all over the top of it. What type of incontinence is defined as dribbling for an overfull bladder? It means being a nurse on labor and delivery. Let me tell you, I remember walking out of the door 6 a.m. before the sun comes up at this time of the year, and then coming home after the sun went down, you know, 6, 7 o'clock at night. It's mostly 7 because you got to get relief in the door. And I'd come home and start cooking dinner or whatever for my oldest, and then I'd stand there in the kitchen going, oh, I forgot to go to the bathroom all day. And I'd have to go all of a sudden, but boy, I have a bladder that can hold gallons. It's amazing, still to this day, so that's awesome. Even at my ripe old age of 51, I still can hold it. Stress overflow, functional or urge? And it is for a dribbling. Overflow, which is easy because they have overly full in the question. And here's the definitions for the rest of them. Urge, and for stress, and for functional. That stress is the funniest one, where we might sneeze or cough and dribble a little bit. It's so funny. Just sometimes, one of those things. This might be a little harder. Which of the following removes urea from blood through nephrons? Something from your science class way back when. My junior high students are learning about this kind of stuff right now. Kidneys, ureters, bladder, urethra. We know the urethra just takes our stuff out of the body, so it's probably not urethra, right? Bladder just holds stuff. So then, you know, don't let the question scare you. You can ration out it by looking at the different parts. The ureters take the stuff from the kidneys to the bladder. So, yeah, you know, kidneys is it. Very good. I have the definitions for the other ones just in case you needed them. Good job. Good job. Thank you for the 8,000 likes and the 7 shares. Appreciate it. If you haven't followed, be sure and follow. The subscribers get their name put in the cookie jar for free copies of my notes from the sections or free tutoring one-on-one for me. We'll do some drawings on Friday, so be sure and look out for that. And y'all get extra drawings for being subscribers. If you want to get in on the drawing and you want to do it for free, which is perfectly fine, be sure and email me at medicalcodingbyjen@gmail.com. Put raffle in the header. That way I know I don't have to go in there and answer that email right away. But I've got your name there. And I can put your name down. I'll be updating all my little pieces of paper for the raffle tomorrow. So be sure and get your name in. Send me an email. If you need any notes or tutoring, of the following, which means relating to lacrimal system, tear. This is always on there. I know this is an eye surgery, right? And we remember Draco. Anybody who's been around and watched me this year, I talk about Draco always crying. I don't know why this name reminds me of Draco, but I think it's because I'm dyslexic. And the letters, if you mix them up, would end up eventually getting to Draco. If you scramble them. But anyway. Yeah. Thank you for the follow. Be sure and follow if you're interested in passing your medical coding exam. I teach from the exam point of view, show you how to pass. This is a little bit different with the anatomy today, but wanted to boost people's scores lately. I got some scores back that I posted up. Our lovely Chrissy, who I've been tutoring, she did so well. She got 100% on E&M on her recent take. She also got... Oh, my kids are back home. Sorry, my kids are coming in the door. Where's my screenshots? I was trying to find them. Screenshots. Yep. Look at her lab and pass scores. We're like, 83 and 100 on medical terminology. And then she had 100 on E&M and compliance and regulatory 100. I was like, oh, rock on.
We're back.
Hey, how was dinner?
Good.
Did you have a good time? Did you eat steak?
She got me a,
okay, go get your shower.
Oh, yeah, I need a question for my birthday cake.
No, I'm not talking about your birthday cake, baby. I'm teaching students.
Can I have definite?
No, you can't. You know that. It's not for you. It's for your family and friends that show up for your birthday. We've discussed this many times. James, you can get started on your homework. You can just move the Oculus out of the way, please. You have pen and paper. Did you eat steak?
Yeah, I still have some.
Okay. Did you say hello to Grandma and give her a hug?
No.
Why not?
The arm fell off.
Yeah, I gotta go glue him back on. Go say hi to your grandma and then get started on your homework. Sorry, guys. My kids walked in. They were gone to a dinner. How many of... Okay, so they've got it separated. You got medical terminology, which has like 5 or 6 questions. And then you've got anatomy, which is 6 questions. So in those two areas, you've got 12 questions. You've got a 100-question exam. But this anatomy will help you picking out which codes would be correct, because you need to know in that whole urology section for those 6 questions, what part of the body are you working with? Are you dealing with the bladder, the ureters, or the kidneys? Knowing that is half your battle in that whole urology section. So super important to know a lot of anatomy technically for the whole exam. So I know we get kind of frustrated, like we need to know everything that the doctor knows, and we don't get paid as much as the doctor, so it's rough, but we need to know quite a bit of it for the exam. Hello, Alaska. Good to see you. Dawn, I know your name is in there, Miss Gomez. I know your name is in there. I wrote your name, actually, and your piece of paper is whiter than everybody else's in there, actually, because you ended up at the bottom of a piece of paper, and I forgot to cut the bottom part, so you are in there. I remember your name vividly, so you are there. I got you. Hi from Texas. Watching you in Oklahoma. My Uncle David and Aunt Debbie live in Texas. Susie. I'm sure I've got a Susie in there, a couple of Susies, so I'm pretty sure. All right, let's get to the next anatomy question. All right, which key root word for lab and path means small? Not too bad. Y'all should be able to get that one.
She didn't let me read my books.
She didn't let you read your books at the dinner?
No.
You could have read them in the car, yeah. I guess.
It was too dark.
Not when you left.
Yeah, I was just waiting to like get to dinner, but then...
I'm sorry. A, everybody's with A. Very good. A is the answer. Here's the definitions for the rest. M-Y-C with the O, which is funny because M-Y-O means muscle, but M-Y-C-O means fungus. Be sure you know that one. And then path means disease, and vi means viral. The only one that's crazy is that one. All right, cardiovascular prefix. Which one of these is defined as fast? Should be a super easy one. Yep, brady means slow, epi means on top. Very good. We've got all the definitions here for you, just in case you didn't know them. D means down. Good job. What type of incontinence, oh my, another one, is defined as leakage that occurs immediately after an urgent void? So this one's different than the last question, but still a type of incontinence. Here's your answers. Is it urge, stress, overflow, or functional? Hope you wrote down your definitions from earlier. Thank you for the follow, Woods. Let me set up another goal since TikTok is fussing at me. Hold on. Let me pull y'all down for just a second. Oops. Ooh. Do I need to, I have 15 subscribers. That's right. So I need to make another goal for that. I set that subscription goal. And then now I got to do a new goal for the other thing, the target thingy. Mm-hmm. I just reset it. Did that go back? Start a new goal. There we go. Sorry, guys. Take me just a second to finish this. I'm not very fast at this. Start a new goal. Cancel. Cancel. Target. Yes. Yes, that's what I needed. I like the kitty cat paws. Let's do that again. That was cool. All right. Now I'm back. Get y'all back up here in the cranny thing. The live on Sunday, will it be posted? I was at work and missed a lot of it. It is posted up, so is Saturday's, but it's the replay is for the YouTube subscribers. I need to make new content for them, and either I make more new content or I make my surprise TikTok lives that I do available for them only, or I have to create new content. So I thought that was a way to where they get something for their subscription to my YouTube channel. It's cheaper than TikTok subscription. I think it's $4 instead of this one's $5. But they get access to old workshops too. And then they got access to the impromptu book prep or whatever I was doing on Saturday and Sunday. So it is posted. Mm-hmm. It's just probably the subscription thing where you can't see it, unfortunately. But all the replays here for Monday, Wednesday, Friday are open for everybody, free of whatever. It's just I would have to, I don't know. I don't know what to do with all these subscriptions and do for the subscriber. So I'm trying to make things that I'm already doing available and fit in these niches so that the time that I have can be spent with getting more tutoring done or making more content or notes for you guys. So I'm trying to manage all of it for you guys. And the money from those subscriptions from TikTok so far has been $23. YouTube, I think I have $55 so far. That money is going to free tutoring for you guys and the drawings that I'm doing on Friday for the free notes. So it's all going back to you guys anyway. Anyway, and the YouTube subscribers and the TikTok subscribers get extra names thrown in to the cookie jar. All right. This one, answer for the urgent, is the urge one. That one is the urge one. The one where the leakage occurs immediately after an urgent. See how they still have the name in there for urge? Thank you for the goal. Y'all are awesome. Here's the definitions for those again, just in case you missed it the last time. Thank you for the kitty cat paws. All right, guys. What about which of the following is regions is for the hips? Thank you for the 12,000 likes and the 8 shares. Anybody know which one of these is hips? I figured I'd trick somebody on this one. I got D. I got A. Don't Google. Only use your CPT, ICD-10, or HipHix book in case. Don't look at me, James Michael. They ain't doing your homework.
Well, you said don't Google.
I did. I wasn't talking to you. I was talking to my students. I'm not talking to you. My child turned around and was like, what? Because he's sitting there doing his homework. He's like, that's all I'm going to do is Google the answer. Lord knows I don't want to do much in your homework. Oh, my gosh. Look at that. Thank you for all the cat paws, Melinda. That's awesome. Thank you. All right. Our answer is A. Good job, guys. That is our region of the hips. Here's the definition for all the rest, too, just in case you needed them. Yes, A was our answer. A was our answer. All right. Our next one, what is another name for this atrial ventricle valve? For the right one. Sorry, I forgot to add the right. Thank you for the substar. You got my emojis as a subscriber. You've got the emojis of my notes, like copies of my notes that you can put in chat. There's also emojis for Travis being all crazy with his goggles on his face. It's too funny. Y'all got emojis. Miss Jen, I have to leave today. When can I watch this video? As soon as I download it and post it, honestly, it'll probably be tomorrow around noon. Okay? Good night. I'll see you later. I've got an A and a C. It's definitely going to be a valve, right? We've got three of them that say valve. Good night. You are done with today's, all of your lessons and all of your classes, and you started 60 seconds ago. My child. Anybody want to raise a 13-year-old? Bruh. Don't bruh me. I'm not your bruh. The answer is C. We've definitely got our tricuspid. I do have the definitions here. So the correct answer is tricuspid. The right atrial ventricle valve has three flaps called cusp. Tricusp, because it has three cusps. And it regulates the flow of the right atrium and the right ventricle. That should be in your cardiovascular section. You can write it in where the pictures of the hearts are at on that page of the anatomy. Lord knows I got a mess of stuff written on mine. Super handy to know. I do these lives 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 6:30 Arizona time zone. Right now we've got 7:30, and I do them for 2 hours, and then I repost them onto YouTube if TikTok records it. Sometimes some of them get lost, and TikTok has a glitch, and they don't record them, but they've been pretty good lately. Knock on wood. But I do repost them and put them on YouTube for you free. It's all under medicalcodingbyjen.com. All right. Most codes for pregnancy require a final character indicating the trimester of the pregnancy. It's usually the seventh character, 0, 1, 2, whatever. Which of the following describes the first trimester? And if you don't have the trimesters written out in your female genitalia area in your CPT book, you're at a disadvantage. Just go on and go find a table that lists you out all the trimesters and when the date starts, when they end, and just put that table in your book. That way you've got it. You're able to write in your CPT book, ICD-10, and HIPPICS. Whatever you want, as long as you're not creating new writable space, don't write over their words that they have written But any available white space you can write on. Less than 14 weeks and 0 days. Here's your list of what to write. There's your first trimester, there's your second trimester, and there's your third. The answer was it B? It is B, right? Less than, yeah, there you go. And there's your trimesters in case you wanted to write them out. You didn't have to do anything in the math workbook last 2 days.
I'm doing it.
Cardiovascular suffix, meaning small. Anybody know this one? Oh, look at my Lester.
He's in his nice new bed. You a good boy. You a good boy. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Is that a good spot? Oh, is that a good spot? Good job.
Sclerosis or stenosis? Miss Sands got it right. We've got OLE. So that would have been B, means small. Here's the definitions for all of them. These would be really good in your cardiology section. The picture of the heart in your CPT book, be sure and write any of those you don't know or all of them. I like to write it even if I do know it by heart, I like to write them because the stress of the exam can make you lose whatever you know by heart. So I like to put it all in the book. And that way I've got it there for reference in case I have a brain malfunction during the middle of the exam. So thank you for the follows. I hope I can help you. Hey, lady. Thank you for the good luck. Lumbar plexus serves which of the following? Are we talking head, chest, back, pelvis? What are we into with this area? Thank you for the shares. Thank you for the follows. I hope I can help y'all with the medical coding. I like to teach for free. So that's why I do this Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. And I like to show y'all from the exam point of view what to expect from the questions, how to find the answers. We got a lot of B's and C's and D's. Oh my, all over the place. What's it say? I took my exam last weekend and I got my results today and I failed. My second attempt is on 12/31. You're going to do it, but at least think of that as a learning opportunity. I think the exam should be taken twice. That way your first attempt is not so stressful. You go in there, you're going to learn about what to expect. You can highlight codes that are on the exam as possible answers, write down certain words that are definitions. You can come back home, study that specifically, and 4 weeks or so later, go take it again to pass. Makes it a lot easier for you guys. Whole lot easier. And it's, you'll know what to expect next time. All right. We've got our back and abdomen, groin, thighs, knees, and calves. That is C is our answer for the last one. Here is the definitions for cervical plexus, brachial plexus, lumbar plexus, and sacral plexus. That way you know the differences in any of those. No matter what they put in the question, you'll have the anatomy for each one. Kind of like you need the anatomy for the upper right quadrant, upper left quadrant, lower left quadrant, that kind of thing. You need these plexuses too, and that'll help you. I like the eliminate what answers isn't, so I can focus on the two options. Yep, me too. I love that technique. Absolutely. Where to find what, go-kart? Fail both times with a 52 and a 59. Username taken. Have you tried Pocket Prep? If you've taken the exam before, let me find, what am I supposed to be under? Yeah, I'm supposed to be right under this one. If you've taken the exam before and you have not passed, and let me see, do I have it up? I don't think I have it up. And you have studied AAPC's exams A, B, C, D, E, and F that you purchase to practice for the exams. You've done Quizlets. You've done all that. Pocket Prep has a AAPC. So you go to pocketprep.com. And you go to your prep exam, just pick medical, wherever I can find that at. Let me see. What is it? What am I supposed to be searching for? Medical? Yeah, there we go. There's the page. You go to medical, and it's the first one. And right here, it tells you about what they offer. They have 500 questions with rationale. And they seem to be written by AAPC. They do have an app you can put on your phone, and you can get scores based off your weakest and lowest. They do have every category, including anatomy and compliance and all that stuff. They even tell you the page numbers where to find the answers, but you got to have an AAPC ICD-10 book and an AAPC HPICS book. To be able to have this work for those particular questions. But all the CPT answers, they give you the page numbers of where to find the answers. They have a money-back guarantee. And the price is not bad at all. So they've got our pass guarantee right there. And see the prices? It's one of those subscriptions, so you got to go back in and turn it off when you get ready. But at $35 for 3 months for 500 questions, because you pay $150 for, no, it's $150 for 300 questions from AAPC, or $300 for 600 questions. So $35 for access to 500 questions is great. They give you a question of the day. You can do it at the phone, during your line at the bank, or at the grocery store. You can do it while you're, you know, in a meeting that could have been an email, whatever. I like them. To give you an example of what a question would look like, here's one. The question of today is, if a patient suffers from PCOS, which is what? Polycystic ovarian disease, right? Which body system would be affected? And it's female reproductive, right? And then you can check your answer. If you got it wrong, you can hit the explanation. It'll tell you where to find the answer in the AAPC ICD-10 on page 528. It will tell you the definition of PCOS. It's amazing. I love them. I think they're pretty good questions. You can make yourself a timed 10 questions. You can build your own. You can just do the ones you've missed. You can figure out your weakest subject. But I don't recommend these questions for people who have never attempted the questions yet or the exam yet. Only for our repeaters who have continually not passed and they've done everything else, then go here. It's too many questions. 500 is a lot, and you'll get confused if you've never done it before. I still highly recommend you buy all of AAPC's practice exam questions. Sorry, I'm trying to buy flights for my son's best friend here with AAPC. I recommend you get all of their practice questions from AAPC because they're the ones writing the certification exam. And we're going to go right there. And I recommend you buying, I've bought way too many questions. But if you're going to take the CPC exam, you should buy all these exams from them. A, B, C, D, E, and F. It'll cost you $300 for all of them, but it's their questions from their point of view, and they also are the questions that they write. What can I do for I? Oh my God, my cat, he is amazing. He's amazing. Well, y'all, look at that cat. He is so funny. All right, but these questions from AAPC are from AAPC's point of view. They write them, and they have the rationale. You don't have to do all 50 at one time. These are meant to be done multiple times, all the time. Pick you an answer, and then hit grade. Even if you only have time to do one question, nobody's going to be tracking your answers or anything like that. Just hit grade. If your kids are in the bathtub or going potty for a second, you got 5 minutes, go do one question. If you get it wrong, then look at your rationale. But if you've never taken the exam, start with these. They're expensive, I know, I'm sorry. But you get a year's access, and they're from their point of view. You need to find out and not memorize what the answer is. James, you can read in your room or you can find something else to clean. Okay, kitchen table. You need to find out, well, why is this answer wrong? Why would it? What's the difference between this answer and that answer? It's because we got two codes and a modifier. Why do we need two codes and a modifier? And whatever the answer is, you should go to that CPT code right there and write that answer with a little bit of information from this question to say that if I had to do a patient who needs a full excision of that lesion and whatever else they had done, this would be the answer. That way you've got a full book of examples from their practice questions to look at. So if we did a dual chamber transvenous transplant with a pacing cardio defibrillator system, what would the answer be? Well, it's going to be 33249, my favorite cardiology code. I love that one. Awesome code. So, super important. It already includes fluoroscope guidance. That kind of stuff is what you should be doing with all 300 of those questions. Then attempt your test. If you don't pass and you need more study material, that's where you go to pocket prep, okay? Because these will just be overwhelming with that other 300 when you haven't even worked up the other 300. Those are more important. Now, if you've already worked up the 300 and you want 500 more to work up, then go for it. But I really recommend you try to attempt the exam first. I know, Kenza, I'm so proud of you. Good job. Yep, now you got to maintain your membership. That isn't hard to do. First thing you need to do is, of course, go to training. You're going to go right there to your CEU search. Then you're going to go down to where it says low cost right there. Then you're going to go down to test yourself with these monthly magazines, and you're going to go back to the last 12 months of magazines. So you can go back and you can do November of 01 right now before the end of the month. Be sure and get that done before November goes by because they're going to delete this one. Take this test. I've already got the answers. You can see that really, really quick if you watch. and take some screenshots. Here's the answers to it. We got C, B, B, D, C, A, C, D, D, B, D, C, D. Good gracious. It's just 20 questions. As soon as you get done, it will automatically track and throw your CEU into your tracker, and it will automatically count your CEU credit that you get from that, and it's free. Also, you guys that are trying to pass the CPC exam, y'all can go in here at the same time. You can go back here, and you can go to November right now. Take these practice exam questions. Try to do the answers. Not all of them are going to apply for CPC. Some of them are going to be for CCS, or they're going to be for CPMA. But they're all good questions. But this is all free questions for you guys that will add you 20 more that you can do. You know you're not going to get your CPC this month in November. They do have rationales with them. So you can practice with these questions too. Just don't do all of the magazines, because when you do pass, you're going to want to save these and do these for the free CEUs, because you're going to have 36 of them due by a certain date. I don't know how to look at mine. Let me see. Do I hit add? I think. Yeah, I only need 11 more. So it automatically tracks all those and throws them in there for you when you do them. So I've got just a few tiny more to do before the end of the year. So anyway, more practice questions there for sure. I'm planning on taking the exam next year. Should I wait until January to purchase the practice questions? Yes, the study guide is super helpful. They give you a year's access to the questions. So the questions are supposed to change yearly. They really don't 100% a bunch, but you could be practicing with those questions right now, and especially with those free ones with the CEUs, you could be already there practicing those questions. And that's the main thing, is you're going to want to practice a bunch of questions. Go to these monthly magazines. They used to have open all the year's old ones, but they cut it down to where they only allow 12 to be open per year. But go to November's, go on and copy all these answers and questions down and get them in your books. That's even more reference material in there for your notes. Start with these, and then yes, January 1st, go in and buy your practice exams, A, B, C, D, E, and F. You'll have access to them all year. They do change a little bit some months. Every once in a while, they'll throw a new question into one of those exams or take one out. We all do get some variations of those questions. Some are not all 100% the same for each person, but sometimes they are. It just depends, but I don't know. Anyway. OMK, don't be losing no hope. You got it, girl. We've got to have you a less stressful situation before you take your exam, hopefully. You're welcome. For Kinza, should I buy new books since mine are 20? Yes. If you, Miss Officer, unless you're going to take the exam before the end of December 31st, you can still use your 2021 books. But as of January 1st, you have to have a 2022 or a 2023 book. Look for a 2022 one in your local Goodwills or other places. They should be going on sale fairly cheap lately. Yeah, those are all free CEUs. These that I'm showing you right now in the magazine, these are all free. Somebody copies them and resells them. This person, I know y'all have seen these books being sold. That's where she gets all her questions from and resells them. He, she, whoever. Aw, you're welcome. You're welcome. Yes, I am going over questions tonight. We have done a bunch of anatomy questions already. I'm going to finish up with those and then we'll do some more. Can you take the exam with your books that have noted in them? Of course. Yep. Look at that. You can absolutely, for sure, anything you want to write in these books, you can absolutely have written in these books as long as you are not writing over the top of their print. In and around the white spaces, you go. Whatever you want to write. Those practice exam questions. Just a little scenario about what's going on, about those dual chamber pacemakers, issue with a battery and had a malfunction. How would you code it? Right there. How would you code a dual chamber pacemaker generator upgrade? There you go. Just anything. You can write whatever you want. As long as you're not writing over their print, you are good to go. Absolutely. I don't have any tutoring, I bet. I don't. Yes. I'm so sorry. It has been crazy ride. Who am I tutoring tomorrow? Unless they reschedule. Who am I tutoring tomorrow? Oh my God, my phone wants to update. What's tomorrow? Tomorrow's Thursday. Yeah, I know I've got somebody Thursday. And then I got MK on Friday. I might have a Monday free, but I don't have this weekend ready. Where do we get anatomy? Where do you get those anatomy questions from? From AAPC, from Pocket Prep, from those practice exam questions, from the magazines, from AAPC. Get them from there too. Also, there is a... Oh, hold on. VitaSource. I bought the Ahima workbook. This is an Ahima workbook, the clinical workout book. I like this one because it's got beginner exercises and then intermediate and then advanced. CPC is more of the beginning, maybe a little bit of the intermediate, but none of the advanced coding. The PCS thing that they add at the end where you're adding the billing codes for the 16 long digit things, you don't need none of that. But some of the stuff I get it from Ahima too. They've got a nice book. They don't do everything as A, B, C, or D. But I like this book. The books don't come with answers. You have to be a teacher and log on and download the answers from them for every other answer. They don't even give you all the answers. So before y'all go buying this book, you'll be given a code and then you'll go in and you'll have to make a HEMA account on their website. You'll put in that code from buying the book, so don't ever buy it used because you've got to buy a new book with a new code for it to work. And then you download the answers, but it's only going to give you either the odds or the evens. I forget which one it was, but I like some of their questions. Sometimes I get them from there too. Sometimes they're fill in the blank questions. And if I'm only getting the even answers, sometimes that's only the fill in the blanks. So then I have to make up an A, B, C, or D to go along with it. But sometimes I get them from here too. So they've got pretty good questions in these books. But you don't have answers to all of them. So that is the downside. And some of them are filling the blank. Your ear is still hurting.
No, but what's look up? At it. This is like really serious. It's like white, like the outer rim. And the, there's like, can you take a picture?
I can't take a picture.
Like, there's like a black line going to it, and there's like a hole in my ear.
You're holding your, oh my Lord. Yep. Yep. We're going to have to put some antibiotic stuff in it, okay? Remind me when I get off my live, all right? Yeah. Sorry, y'all, just looking in the disgusting ear. We were trying to zoom in. Zoom in. Huh?
Did you see that it was white tumor side?
Yes, white means infection. It just means that your body is sending lymphocytes there to fight the infection. So, you know, their little musket guns are shooting off with a little white powder. And it's all building up with the white musket stuff. I don't know. My mother used to tell me that, you know, the little fighting guys are shooting their little guns at the bad guys and making the little white puffs of smoke. That's why you got the white stuff coming out of your little wound. Anyway. All right. Do you sell books with answers already in them? No. All these questions that I share with you guys are written by other people like AAPC, AHIMA, Reputable Places, Pocket Prep. They're good questions and they're copyrighted. It's somebody else's stuff. I don't sell their material. I don't sell their questions. But I'm able to, as a teacher, teach in a group setting with you and show you how to answer the questions and explain rationale with them. And I'm happy to do that, but I don't sell any practice questions or anything like that. If I had time to write my own, they'd probably be more difficult, but I'd love to maybe one of these days. But what I would like to do is do more of a study guide type situation that explains a particular component, like E&M. Let's explain what the difference is between new patient and established, and then have you do your new patient and established patient questions right after I explain it, and then move it at 8 o'clock at night. Aww, look at the buddy. Okay, and then move down to explain what the difference is between like observation and inpatient hospitalization, and then have you practice a bunch of those questions so that you could get that down pat before we moved on to another explanation of another section of E&M. I have it in my head what I want to do, but having the time to do it, I would have to quit my job, my daytime job, to be able to do that. I have something in mind, but I don't know when I could find the time to do all that. And then bigger practice exam at the end, after all is said and done, that you could take. But it'd still have to be all my questions and all my rationale and all my study guide material that I would want put in with how to do the notes for that section in what book. So it would be a combo of all of that I offer, but I don't know. I don't have the time to do it yet, but I would love to. Best way to study is, I have a pinned TikTok in my TikToks. It says, where do I start? Watch that. 3 minutes of your time. It'll show you what book to get, what to study first. Right now, y'all should be looking in a CPC study guide from AAPC, and I show you how to look one up and how to find one the cheapest way. Get that to your house, and then you need to order a 2023 CPT book, and then it shows you how to do your step-by-step book prep for that, all in those TikToks. So look at the 3 pinned TikToks. That'll get you started. We have 4 questions in anesthesia during the exam. Thank you, Melinda. You're awesome. Yes, after you have your CPC, you can absolutely apply to any clinic at all. Highly recommend you start going to the you know, if your town is doing like Corn Fest or Fall Fest or holiday little open houses or things where they do in carnivals in town, start taking a resume with you, because let them know. The home health agencies, doctor's offices, the dentist office, they're all there passing out toothbrushes and whatnots, hand sanitizer, and they're trying to get more patients. Well, you could walk by and say, I'm a coder. If you happen to need a coder or would just like some advice on a sticky issue that you're having with not getting paid on something, here's my number. Call me and I'll see if I can't help you with your idea or your issue. Offer to volunteer for a quick issue and then Google the dang answer when they tell you what was going on. Well, let me check on that and let me see what I can figure out and I'll call you back, kind of like situation. And then prove yourself cool or ask me how to get the billing done for them, whatever. And, you know, make yourself available in your town and neighborhood and go to any open houses of any radiology departments that are opening up, adding to their departments, ambulance services, you name it. Go to every health fair. Make yourself known. Yep. Absolutely. Beginners go to surgery centers, probably, more than likely, or home health agencies. Absolutely. There's another anatomy, a connection between the gallbladder and the intestine. What would it be? Creating. Creating? Is that a graphy? Or would it be a tomy? That would be the first thing I would be thinking about in this question for sure. Some of them are angio versus cysto. So knowing those prefixes, suffixes will definitely help you out. And your answer is that D? That is D? That is D. D is your answer. And here's the definitions for all four, just in case you need it. Yep, good job, MK. Oh, Lord, my formatting was all off on this one. I had the worst trouble with Word documents sometimes. The following is defined as an artificial opening between the stomach and the abdominal wall. Is it a graphy? That's more like radiology and imaging, right? So, plasty is a repair. What you think? Thank you, Twinkle. Thank y'all for the 14,000 likes. That's awesome. Tomy means incising, making. Yep, sure does. Absolutely. Perfect. Let me do some more kitty cat paws. Where are they at? Those are cute. There we go. Perfect. We've got B for this one. And there's the definition for all of them. Oh, thank you, Emily, for the kitty cat paws. You're awesome. Thank you, Emily. How about respiratory terms? Diana? Maybe? Dina? I'm terrible with names. Respiratory terms. For puncture of a cavity or an organ to remove fluid. Three of them start with P. I like looking for similarities. But this one does end up being our weird abnormal one, right? It's our C one. It's unusual for AAPC, but interesting. Here's the definitions for all of them, just in case you needed it. Didn't trick anybody with that one. All right, getting close to the end here. Ultrasound image of the brain. Which one is brain? Thank you, Emily. Thank you, Dee. Y'all are awesome. Y'all. Start a new goal? I thought I did. I don't know what that is. There we go. And then, getting more kitty cat paws. That's a subscribers one. I just did that one. Set a new goal. Oh my gosh. Y'all are doing them so fast. That's awesome. Make TikTok super happy. All right. Encephalitis. You talk about encephalitis, those kind of things. That's usually a swelling of the brain. So that's helpful. We have a little bit, maybe they're trying to trick us right here, right? But yeah, D is our answer. Here's your definitions for all four, just in case. Yep, it's perfect, MK. We're still on for Friday morning, right, MK? You're good with that time and that day? Echo. This is my last one, kind of an E&M one, but how many individual body systems are recognized in the review of symptoms? Review. How many can they do? How many individual body systems are there? Somebody says 15. A lot of people are saying 12. Nessa, I'll tell you in just a second. I think D and Sean got it right. We got 14, so we've got B is our answer. There's 14 body systems that you can have in your review of systems. Here they are right here with our constitutional overall look. We've got eyes, ears, nose, mouth, throat. They're all given 1.2. So when you're trying to count up to see how many, if by chance you don't have MDM and you don't have time and you need to count things that they reviewed, this is the list of all of it. So be sure to know all of those and which ones you can count 1 point for each one. Thank you for the follow. And where can I get these practice tests? Yes. So if you go to AAPC website, right? You're going to go to CPC exam training. When you get there, over here on the side, after you click there, it says practice exams. You'll click here, scoochie down, and it's got all of them listed here. I kind of like the bundles because they're only $79 each. You get exams A, B, and C, or D, E, and F. You can buy A, B, or C by themselves, but I don't recommend that. I don't guess you can buy D, E, or F by itself. I thought you could, but I guess not. But that is 300 questions, right? Or more, somewhere around there. They're 50 each, 50 times 6 is whatever. you just put that and put that in your cart. Do not check that bunch right there. Just check this one and hit it, add to your cart. Then when you do purchase them, to find them in your account, you'll go to My AAPC. You'll go to My Purchased Items. It'll only bring up your exams. You got to click the tab that says Items. Then all the practice exam questions that you purchased, and I've purchased a bunch for a bunch of specialties because I teach a bunch of them, will be right here. And this is where you will practice and take them. You'll just click on the exam. The first time you do it, it'll ask you to not, you know, resell or copy, paste, and share these openly over the internet. You don't want to do that. Like, you know, put them in a PDF and just send them to everybody else because they want their money for their time and effort of creating their questions, of course. But once you've already clicked that, you can go straight into each exam. You don't have to answer all 50 at once. You can do just a few at a time whenever you get ready or want to. You know, whatever question you want to do, you can do it open radius with the P1, P2. Whichever one you want to do, you can just do all of them. The cases are the ones down at the bottom. Usually it's the 48, 49, and 50 are the bigger cases that we'll have 10 of those on our exam that you can do. But you don't have to sit there and answer all of them at once. You can just do one or two at a time. I know that one's the answer to that one. You just hit grade. And if you didn't get it right, did get them right, whatever, you can write your rationale. Yeah. And you can go figure out why the wrong answers are wrong and why the right answers are right. And then write you a little scenario about what this is and what the main crux of it next to that first CPT code. And that'll help you the next time you are trying to take an exam. You've got a little scenario written about that question. You've got 300 of them in here for whatever you were doing. So, love it, love it. Be sure and get them from AAPC. And then if you don't pass, only if you don't pass and you need more reference material, go to Pocket Prep and get their membership that has a pass guarantee. You will have to go back in and turn it off, but I recommend the 3 months for $35. You can do these on your phone. You can do these on your desktop. They give you a question of the day, and it's 500 questions with page numbers of where the answers are. Super cool. Super cool questions. But don't try to do all of these and the other ones when you haven't even tried the exam yet. All right. That is my last anatomy question. Was that one? Was the one with the 14? We have 15 minutes left. What kind of questions do y'all want to do? Cardiology? Compliance? I have muscles up. I have ENM up. And I have male and female up, but I did that on Monday. What kind of questions would y'all like? Anybody have a preference? Thank you for the kitty cat paws. Whoops. You're so awesome. Thank you, Sunshine. Compliance. All right, let me pull them up real quick and make sure I don't have anything. Probably wrote all over them. Let's see. Too bad. Not too bad. 2, 3. I wrote all over them, so let me erase some marks. I'm like always writing all over these things. Erase. Easy one first. This one's easy. What is not considered managed health care plan? Super easy one. Yep, workman's comp, for sure. There's your rationale. you link to your Medicare. Let me erase the next one. We'll do a couple of these and then we'll go do some E&M for you. All right. What does the acronym RVU stand for? Value, version, or another value. They got a unit or update. Update. That's funny. Yes, it is C. Very good. Let me erase. Easy ones, easy ones, easy ones. All right. Patient, his or her marital status determines what in the E&M? Exam, history, MDM, or counseling? Thank you, Twinkle. Their history. Yes, perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect. All right. Somebody wanted an ICD-10-1. Here's an ICD-10-1, but it is tied to a compliance guideline. So it's technically a compliance question, but it is an ICD-10-1. So if your patient is pregnant with a UTI, what goes first, N's or O's? Good job, good job. So we can automatically get rid of those two. When we go to our 0, 2, 3, 40, does it tell us anything? Do we have any guidelines attached to that? Oh, 23. O23 tells you, and the only place to find it, is to look at the code by itself without the point 40. Don't go down to the point 40 for these. You need to go to the 0.23 because it tells you you need to use an additional code for any infection or things that might be going on with the body, just in case. So you got to make sure if it's going to be one of these, then we're going to need that. But I don't think we have that. B40, let's check it out. We got B4O. O is unspecified infection, urinary tract during pregnancy, unspecified trimester, which is exactly what we've got anyway. Would we add the N39 with the Z33 or not? We go to our N39, see if we have any instructions on to use also. It's always helpful. N39.0. Right here. Urinary tract infection, non-specified site, use additional if needed. It keeps saying that over and over again, no matter where we're at. Oops. There's your code. So we definitely are going to be D for this one. That's the only things that we needed to diagnose. We don't have any staph infection noted, anything that would be in that B area. And of course, OB is going to trump the urinary infection, even though she was there for the UTI. We do the pregnancy first and then our UTI second. We don't need our Z code. Yep, 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 yep. We're perfect with that one. It depends on what they come in for to know whether you're going to do a Z code first or an O code first. Always depends. Always depends on that. Erase this one. One more ICD-10 and then we'll go to ENM. This one's also tied to a compliance one also. So if you got this wrong, it would be counted against you as a compliance question. So a patient has cancer, the right kidney, and had a transplant. How would you code it? Are we going to code it for cancer first, or are we going to do the, what's that part? The external cause. Always blanking on that name. Do we do external cause first? That is what they're wanting to know. Yep, we're going to do their external cause first, which is the T code. Then we'll do their cancer codes. Yep, for sure. All right, ENM. What have I got going on with ENM today? I don't have these. These are new questions, but I don't have the, I don't have them done up yet. We know this is going to be A, B, C, or D. I just haven't formatted it yet. I posted it here, but I haven't done anything to it. Which one of these is used for home care, ostomies, and stomas? I've not done this question yet. And they're all together, so we can't look for any processes of elimination with these. Would these codes be in the front of your book in ENM, or are they going to be in the back of the book? That's first part of your battle. Allie, all that is done by AAPC. They do a yearly audit of all their CPCs and ask them what their salary is, what region do they live in, and they have a nice drop-down menu, and you can see what area you live in and see what the average pay is. They've done all that legwork. I've been in medicine well over 20 years, but I've been in administration or medical auditing and coding for over 20 of that, so income is exactly where I want it to be. So our 995s are going to be in the back of the book in medicine. And they're going to be with these home health visits right here for the home visits. And then you just look for the one that's got the STOMI, right? We're going to do the 3, the 4, and the 5, and the 6. Which one's for that? And it simply just says this, the 5. All I did was take a different color and I highlighted the different differences so that they popped out at me. We got ventilation care, stoma care, intramuscular injections, catheterizations. That made it easier for me, and they're all different colors. It might not pop up on my screen, but they are. That makes the finding of the answers a lot quicker. Yeah, and then I have the definitions for the all of them, but I just haven't fixed it, 100% formatted that one yet. Let's see about this next one. This one's almost like that other one with the 14 ROSs. How many how many HPI are there in an extended HPI? How many elements are there? A, B, C, or D? Thank you, Twinkle. All you have to do is pay to take the certification exam through AAPC's website and pass the exam. If you pass the exam, then you are good to go. There's no prerequisites. There is no mandatory classes. I like to teach from the exam point of view to show you how to pass the exam. And that's all you got to do is do that. 1 to 3, MK says. 1 to 3. Let's see what they said. 4 or more. That is, they're saying the answer is. Characterizing a patient's HPI in extended HPI typically is 4 or more. Do I have that in my beginning of my ENM? I know I've got something. I know I have something. There's that chart in the guidelines somewhere that is up here in the beginning. What have I got here? Extended HPI? 4 plus, but that's for MDM. That'd be high complexity. I'm trying to see where they had that HPI of extended or more. I'll have to see where I can find that answer at. It's got to be up here. We got the review of systems with our 14. It's got to be history of present illness. It's got to be up here somewhere. Yeah, it is 4 or more for the extended. It is. I'm just wondering where I could point out the answer so you guys could see it. Is all extended? No, that's 2 to 5. HPI. Do I have 4 or more? 4 or more is extended. There it is. I knew I had it freaking written in somewhere. This is my page 11 notes for those that have purchased my notes on ENM. That page 11. 11 there. Oh my goodness. Yeah, that was a good question. 4 or more. There's the rationale for that. Page 11 of the 2022, but it's my notes. So I'm not sure if it's actually written on this page or if it's just my notes making the termination from their notes that they have right there so that I could figure out what they're saying. I like to take their words that are all highfalutin and put it into something that's more rational. And to the point, I hate having 50 words tell me the same thing that 2 words could tell me. It just drives me nuts. So I have to go through there and fix all that, whatever they're saying, because it drives me insane. So I spend way too much time worrying about all that. All right. Let's do one that doesn't give us the MDM or time. We need to figure out if it's going to be a straightforward, low, moderate, or high visit. And all we're going to get is the patient's review of what happened. So I see here we're going over labs, right? So that gives you 1 point, right? Blood work. And then we got an EKG, which will be another point, right? Also reviewed a chest x-ray. That's another one because those are unique tests. All blood work would be unique. all EKGs is unique and chest x-ray is unique. This is where that page 17 comes in handy here, where it's got any combination of the three. So review of prior external each unique source. So we got EKG, chest x-ray, and lab work. That's three right there. And then, oh God, come on camera. It could be over here too with your high complexity. We need a little bit more information to see if we're going to be high. And chest x-ray, which showed vascular congestion. We've got a new problem of edema. Did they resolve it? No evidence of heart attack. Patient also has end-stage renal disease, which is stable, but poor controlled hypertension. Woo! Thank you. I try to. Yep. Spoke to the dialysis, so they consulted other people. When you're here and it says discussion of management and test with other people, other qualified people. Travis, I haven't seen you do any housework or homework. Is that also included here in our moderate? It is included in our moderate, but if we're adding that component and this component, this is at least one out of the three categories, but this one is two out of the three categories, and we have this one done and we have that one done with talking to other people, the other dialysis people, and two of the three makes us a high when this one is done by the one of the three categories, but we have two of them, so that's super important too. So I think we would be high. What do you guys think? And do you want to see more of it? There's the note. Just in case. I can't get it all on one screen, but do you guys think we're high too? We could be moderate, but I really think we're high. It's got to be high because we're doing the consult with the dialysis department. So that throws you into a two of three, gets you high. Yep, there you go. They say we got to high because of the dialysis, the lab, the EKG, and chest x-ray were 3 points. I got that right. And then chronic illnesses posing threatening of life. Yep, and the medical decision making was high. Okay. Yep. Thank you. Thank you, Angel. Well, I hope tonight has been helpful. Been on for 2 hours. We did get to 8:30. I will download this live and post it up on the YouTube. If you haven't yet, I have a free website that you can go to. It's medicalcodingbyjen.com. It's got tons of free information. The social media link page will show you where the Facebook group is, where TikTok is, of course, where the YouTubes are all at. And you can join our free Discord study group. It is super handy dandy. It holds all my pictures and things. But that click will click you right into it. You do need to download your Discord app. But I have practice rooms with practice questions in it, what to expect on exam day, E&M resources, CPT, you name it. Different specialties have their own rooms with practice questions, even have cases, study buddies, CEUs. Once you pass, job resources, you can see everybody that I've helped pass right there. Just tons of free information for you guys. Plus, you get to know when I come in and go live. You can message me here. See, I've got some messages to get to, but I do my best. just keep in mind, I am one person here helping y'all as much as I can, free as much as I can. 6 hours, free teaching, 3 days a week. I got you the Discord, got you the website. Also on the website, if you do join it, which is free, you can go here to CPT Book Prep Room. This room, let me sign in real quick. Kicked me out. Who am I going to sign in as? I'll sign in as myself. Here we go. Go, go, go. And we'll go here. Go back to that CPT Book Prep. It'll show you pages from my CPT book. All you got to do is click on the picture. It'll give you instructions of what I'm doing and why I'm doing it so that you can make your book look like mine too. I do it for ICD-10 and HipPix here too. Show you exactly what I do. There is a shop there that can, it does have pages of all my notes. If you happen to need it page by page and just want a copy, but you don't need it, you can make up your own. There's video book prep for digestive system there. If you need to watch a video of me doing each code individually by itself, I show you where I get my info from and how I mark up the books. I also have that on the YouTube page. Those are under the lives and just a ton of information too on YouTube. So the link is right there if y'all need it. I do have Messenger messages, Facebook emails. Be sure to email me with raffle in the header if you want to be put in for free tutoring hours and free copies of my notes. We're going to have a drawing on Friday. Just put raffle in the subject line. And also, when you reach out to me, just keep in mind, I'm just one person. I do have a real job. Happy to help. That's what I'm here for, is to help you. And I don't care if you buy from me or not. I'll help you out with no matter what. I'm always here to help. And I'm trying to do all I can. It's just, there is a lot of messages coming in from a lot of places. So, and I love seeing all y'all's stories. I love seeing where you've been in your medical field and where you come from. And I do try to get back to everybody. I have Twinkle that helps me out. She's already in need of a pay raise for sure. But if y'all need me, just be patient and be persistent. Just keep messaging me. You're not going to offend me. Just try to reach me if you really need something important that nobody else can answer that's in the study group. But I am happy to help, and I will see y'all again on, God, what's today? Today's Wednesday? Friday? Friday at 6:30 Arizona time zone. We'll do 2 more hours of lessons. With practice questions, we'll do more E&M and whatever subject y'all want to do. I'll tell him you said hi, MK. And I appreciate all the shares and the lives and the kitty cat paw prints today. And TikTok subscribers and YouTube subscribers, the paid subscriptions, get extra names put in for the free drawings of the one-on-one tutoring that I do on Zoom and for copies of my free notes. So I appreciate y'all, and all that revenue that comes in from TikTok or YouTube goes straight back into you guys for free notes and YouTube. Zoom one-on-ones. My brain is falling right now for the Zooms. We also have workshops that I do once a month, and the next one is on December the 11th. You can go on and schedule that already under the website for booking online. It's $10 and it's 3 hours, and we're going to do E&M cases and E&M scenarios. We'll do about 75 questions because I like to keep same pace as what the exam is. So we start right at 2 o'clock Arizona time zone, and we go to 5 o'clock, and we'll do 25 questions per hour. And it's more straightforward. If there's a guideline or a situation where you need to know a certain thing, I'll let you know. But I show you how I would answer every single E&M question for a medical coding certification exam in a timed manner so that you guys can see how what kind of pace you need and where to find the answers. So pretty cool. It's going to be on Zoom, and you just come here to book it if you want to. If you can't attend that Sunday, don't worry about it. You will get access to the Zoom replay after the meeting is finished, and I'll send everybody the logon and password for that afterwards. But you can pre-book right now if you want to. It will be on Sunday the 11th. When you hit the book now, it'll take you to a calendar. Just arrow over to December. You'll see the one date with the one dot. That's what you need to click on. And then you click at the 2 p.m. Once you do that, then your next is ready to go and you can hit book. And it is 3 hours of Zoom. We will do 75 E&M questions. We'll do them at the same pace that expected during the exam, so you know what it's like to do questions in 144 seconds. And plus, you'll get to see tons of scenarios of E&Ms. So super cool. Good value. All right, guys. I'll see you back on Friday. MK, just let Twinkle know you need the logon and password for that workshop from 11-6, and she'll give it to you for you. Tomorrow, I am not. Tomorrow night, I am spending time with those boys of mine. Plus life. I've got a car that we were rear-ended on Halloween night, so I've got to get that thing put in the shop and fixed. Plus job and work and everything else that's going on in my life. And my mom, what do we should she? Oh, I've got my oldest child needs an eye appointment on Thursday, so I'm doing that at noon. Or, you know, life is going on Thursday, but I'll be back on Friday. I will see y'all then. Thank you, Twinkle. All right, guys. I will see you on Friday. Thanks for hanging out.